Welcome back. Another week's gone by, and here we are. As you probably know by now, I'm Dave Wood, and this is Semiosis 101. So if you want to, you can fast forward to today's video, but if you're a newbie, stay exactly where you are. This will be your first Semiosis 101 video. I'm Dave Wood, a design educator and researcher, a published design author, and I've worked commercially as both a freelance illustrator and a graphic designer. I actually use semiotics all the time in my creative work, but probably like yourselves, I was never taught semiotic theory at design school. I'm a Scouser from Liverpool and a new Scot, and this Scout Semiosis 101 YouTube channel focuses on explaining Peircean semiotic theory in a more designer-centric way to visual communication designers, illustrators, graphic designers. The guy behind the theory, Charles Sanders Peirce, wrote the theories in late 19th, early 20th century in North America. Peirce was a philosopher, a mathematician, a theorist, but he wasn't a creative. I myself have a PhD in visual communication, and it took until my doctorate to actually study semiotic theory in order to really understand how to apply semiosis, the active sign action of semiotic signs, when producing visual communication work. As a result, each week on this Scout Semiosis 101 YouTube channel, I'll post at least one 10-minute explainer video on an aspect of Peirce's pragmatic semiotic theory. Each free Semiosis 101 10-minute video will use design-centric terms instead of Peirce's theoretical language so that illustrators and graphic designers can follow and understand. Each video will feature a take-home piece of applicable semiotic theory, and they do interconnect to build up your understanding of semiosis, but this channel is not a course in semiotics per se. Instead, think of each video as a bite-sized piece of illustrated new knowledge on sign action, or semiosis as Peirce names it. The aim of these three videos is to take Peirce's quite complex philosophical theoretical language and put it in the context of designing visual communication, whether these are illustrations, motion, branding, packaging, editorial, etc. So whether you are just interested in semiotics, or you are a semiotician, a visual communicator, an illustrator, a graphic designer, interested in knowing how Peirce's semiosis theory can help to enhance your visual communication skills, then please like these videos, subscribe, and if you want to know when next week's video hits, bang, hit the bell button below to be notified. Let's get to the 11th episode on general Peircean semiotic theory for illustrators and designers. Today, in around 10 minutes, we'll focus on how in semiosis, the representation of the concept effectively works when designing. Last week, we examined using illustration as an example of how, during our ideation phases, iconic, indexical, and symbolic representation of the concept or concepts can be connotatively constructed. Next week, we will look at iconic representation in more detail, but this week, we will deconstruct a piece of familiar design to read it from a Peircean semiosis perspective. I'll begin the semiotic deconstruction at the iconic level of representation, then reconstruct the familiar design, moving from iconic to indexical, and then from indexical to symbolic. It will be a theory-packed 10 minutes of semiosis, but in design-centric terms. The next 10 minutes will be an Olympian task of semiotic deconstruction and reconstruction. So we better get started. Subscribe, hit the bell. On your marks, let's go. Welcome to this week's talk. We're going to be focusing this week on designing semiosis, which follows on from last week's talk, which was illustrating semiosis. Last week we used an illustration example to explore iconic, indexical, and symbolic representation, semiotic representation of a concept. But this week we're going to focus more on graphic design. Okay, so two aspects of visual communication design we're going to focus on. And we're going to be exploring sign action in action. Now, of course, sign action, from Peircean's point of view, as the theorist behind the semiotic theory, the word semiosis is actually his word for sign action, the action of the semiotic sign. And that's what we're going to focus in on. Just the very first one, which is concept, and we're going to focus in on explaining iconic, indexical, and symbolic using a piece of graphic design as a way of explaining the theory and how the theory can enhance visual communication. To do that, we're going to be using a piece of graphic design, a piece of branding, done by the Jack Renwick Studio. Thanks, Jack, for giving me permission to use this example. And it's from 2016, their branding of Carpenter's Wharf, a housing development on Fish Island in Hackney Wick in London. And Carpenter's Wharf is basically redeveloping Fish Island and setting up 35 Canal Side 1, 2 and 3 bed apartments, but rooting those apartments, the branding of it was rooted in the culture of the island, which was basically woodworking and that type of like activity on the island. Just to give a sort of context for this continuation of the island itself on the Thames. So we're looking at continuity here of activity, but obviously moving from actual woodworking and industrial into residential. So that was the big concept behind Carpenter's Wharf as a development. And that's what this branding focuses on. And we're going to explore that through applying semiosis to this 2016 campaign. Okay, so iconic representation is the entry starting point of how semiotics works from a Peircean point of view. What iconic representation does, it represents the concept by providing visual clues, and we're talking visually here, visual clues of what we want our target audience to take from it, to interpret from what we provide them with, for them to make connections to the big concept. So what we have here is the fact that iconic representation picks out the concept by resembling that concept. That iconic representation can only refer to the concept by its perceived resemblance through an association of shared qualities that the target audience are already familiar with. So that's what we're going to explore further as we go through here. So let's just start that exploration now of iconic representation. Well, straight away, what we just saw there on the screen, if you got the word tools in your head, then iconically, you're already beginning to interpret the semiotics underpinning the design. You don't have to know what type of tool these things are. It's just the fact that the shape of the things you recognize as tools. So here we are. We have a tool, another tool, another tool, and another tool. And it's the shapes of those tools. It's the shapes themselves that gives us the sense of what we're looking at is a tool. An object that is a tool. But that's not just all we're looking at here. We also have the fact that the left-hand part of the branding, we have the shape of a house. Now, fundamentally, as children, when we're told at school, draw a house, draw your house, we come down to this iconic level of what is fundamentally a house shape. But we might have lived in flats, we might have lived in big country houses, we might have lived in two up, two down terraced houses. Our actual physical house had no connection to the shape that we drew, except that when we're told to draw a house, we know it's got a roof, walls, and a floor. And that's what we draw. We draw something that resembles a concept of what we think a house is. And that stays with us all through life. So a very fundamental starting point of iconicness begins as a child. it begins with us being human. But all of these things, I've drawn shapes here to focus on the shapes, but also we have the wood print of the wood grain. And if you look at the imagery again, you see that the shapes themselves are built up of sections of printed wood. So this is wood that's been, as in printmaking, rolled with ink and then paper pressed over the top of it to capture the wood grain, and then that has been used to create the imagery that you see. So this itself is also iconic because it's iconic of the wood grain. It resembles the wood grain. It's come from the wood grain, but it resembles wood grain, and wood resembles natural materials. So iconically, there's a lot going on in these imagery, in this imagery that is iconic in nature, that starts off our wonder and discovery of what does all this mean. What does this mean? Well, let's move up one level. If you got as far as tools, then iconically, these like shapes made out of blocks of printed wood grain, gets you to this point. That if you know from the left to the right that the first object is a wood plane, the second object is a wrench, third object is a wood saw, and the fourth object is a hammer. If you got to this point of being able to name them, already these imagery is moving up the levels of semiotic communication into what we call indexical. Think about your index finger. It points to specific existent things. A wood plane, a wrench, a wood saw, a hammer. Because it picks out the concept by means of pointing to an existent thing. So as designers, if we craft our iconic representation in such a way, then some people, some of our target audiences will make the connection, the interpretation we want them to say, ah, that is this, pointing at it. That is a wood plane. That is a wrench. That is a wood saw. That is a hammer. All of these things are indexical representation. It's still the same image, but once you start making the interpretation at a higher semiotic level of this is an actual existent thing. And when I say existence, I'm not talking about it has to be a real thing. It could be an idea. Trolls don't exist, but it may be representational of a troll. Okay, that is an existing thing in popular culture and in folklore, but it doesn't exist, but it still could be referenced indexically through visual means, that we see the shape of the elements, which is the iconicness, to then go, ah, all those shapes put together, that means a troll. But in this case, it's not a troll, it's a hammer. Let's move up to the next level, which is the top level of semiotic communication, which is symbolic representation. And it picks out the concept we want to communicate via a convention or a rule. What do we mean by that? Well, we're talking about this piece of graphic design as a piece of branding. It's branding Carpenter's Wharf on Fish Island in Hackney Wick in London. It's actually pointing us to not just an existent thing, Carpenter's Wharf, but when we see the branding and all the elements of the branding, or the tools, or the wood grain, like house shapes and all the other elements that are part of the branding campaign, it all points to this physical location, which is 35 Canal Side 1, 2 and 3 bed apartments on the canal, which is called Carpenter's Wharf. So as soon as we start seeing all these images in a particular way that we know the meaning of it is actually, ah, that's like Carpenter's Oaks, Carpenter's Wharf development area where the houses are, where you've got 1, 2 or 3 bed apartments, all of these things means this place. That is the convention or the rule that we, as the target audience, learn. So let's just go back a few steps. And what we have is, at an iconic level, the resemblances to some things that we already know. Once we get the connection of, that is this, then we're starting to move up to indexically to the final stage where it all works together semiotically to actually, once we know what the real concept is, in this case, it's Carpenter's Wharf, a housing development, then that is where the same piece of design works at the higher level. So the same piece of design can work at iconic level if the audience interprets a lot more from it. It can start working at the indexical level. And then if the target audience gets the full concept, then it works at the symbolic level of representation. So hopefully that gives you an insight on how semiosis works through the representation of the concepts we want to communicate through iconic, indexical, and symbolic. But we will be coming back to those terms in more depth over the coming weeks in future videos. But for now, that's the end of today's video. Come back again next week. And that's it for now. So that was our 10 minutes of Peircean Semiosis 101 for this week. Well, you follow me through this semiotic deconstruction, reconstruction so far. You will have noticed I use terms such as resemblance, qualities, existence, conventions, and rules in the semiotic deconstruction of Jack Renwick Studios' Carpenter's Wharf brand identity in the context of semiosis. This is because theories and practice in semiosis are entwined with qualitative and existential connections. Peircean Semiosis provides us with how the visual language used can be tailored to our intended audiences. Then the qualitative and existential connections to what the audience already know provides illustrators and designers with why our visual communications semiotically work. Peircean Semiosis utilizes the sign action power between what the concept is, how the concept is represented to facilitate a successful interpretation by our audience. Now, this audience's connotative interpretations can be manipulated and guided by effective use of iconic, indexical, and symbolic representation in the visual language we use based upon what they already understand. There will be another video next week, so come back again. By following this Scout Scott YouTube channel, you will learn how Peircean's pragmatic semiotic theory or semiosis can help to enhance and improve how you visually communicate. I have many more Peircean semiotic topics to discuss, but I would be interested in hearing about your semiotic ideas. Add a comment below. And if you like this video, check out my other semiotic videos. Consider liking and sharing the videos with others. The more we creatives discuss semiotic theory, the easier its application into our creative processes will be. Over the years, I have collaborated with other design academic researchers and Peircean semioticians to develop a designer-centric explanation of Peircean's theoretical language. If you are interested in reading my Semiotic Rosetta Stone academic writing, then you can visit my Academia Edu link in the description. As a fellow creative and a published design author, I also have links in the description to my Scout Scott Redbubble shop featuring illustrated and typographical gift ranges. And to my 2014 design book published by Bloomsbury Publishing, Interface Design, an Introduction to Visual Communication in UI Design. Any other books on Peircean semiotics I've mentioned in the videos are also listed in the description. Check them out too. Thanks for watching. Check out the other videos, like and share them with your friends, and hit the bell button to be notified when next week's video is published. So see you all again next week for more Semiosis 101 to help illustrators and designers to enhance your visual communication skills.